have applied the gap equation to ceiling treatment on pine wood. In the presentation of today, I will provide you a brief introduction about what are our research topics and in which framework we are conducting this kind of experiments, and then I will go in detail in the study. So, the first important aspect for us is to study the effect of the climate change. So, everyone is always interested on what is the effect of hazard, for example, of flood, coastal erosion, sea level rise. But in our case, we are more interested on slope change. So it means what happens if you have the environment that is changing slowly. What happens specifically if the relative humidity is changing. And we are interested to study what is the effect of this change on wood, on the wood material, and specifically on historic wood, and why on wood, because wood is a higroscopic material that suffers a lot from modification of relative humidity. So it can gain moisture or lose moisture, and in this way it can also deform, and as the wood is an anisotropic material, you have deformations that are different on the three different axes. As you can see from this map, we have different objects on wood in cultural heritage. We have both movable and immovable heritage, so it means from statue, painting to real building, and in the case of Norway, we have amazing buildings that are called state churches, that are medieval churches made of pine. And why is it important for us to study the effect of this modification of relative humidity on wood? Because there are a lot of conservators, politicians that are asking for new knowledge about the new sensitivity of wood in time of climate change. So why, for example, they are observing more decay? They do not understand what are the boundary conditions that they need to consider to preserve well this material. Boundary condition means that they need information about what is a safe range of relative humidity to maintain into a church, for example, to preserve the wooden wall or the wooden structure. And so they are asking for more research on sensitivity and also for more information about when to adapt a specific option, conservation option, in order to keep the risk always at acceptable level and never going towards intolerable risk of plastic deformation, for example, on wood material. Within this research framework, therefore, we are conducting research in the symbol project that stands for sustainable management of heritage building on a long-term perspective that is focused on the protection of the wooden structure into the state church. So within this project, we are using a non-destructive technique, that is the acoustic emission, to monitor the stress released by the material under change, Higrid change, so it means under change of relative humidity. And we perform a monitoring campaign in Trondheim, in a house that is a building from the 18th century that was used in the past to store fish, stock fish. So this means that practically every surface of wood is soaked, is decayed by the presence of salts that remain on the material. And we tested with acoustic emission several logs of a wall into this building, and you see what is the effect on the long term of this salt weathering. Practically, the wood completely changed. We have another material, we have a sort of soft wood that is called fuzzy wood. And then with the same technique, we are also conducting long-term monitoring in the two state churches to see what is the effect of the use of the church in terms of presence of visitors and also, for example, use of the heating system that therefore decrease the condition of relative humidity. And we are detecting released by the material and eventual microcracks propagation. In the laboratory at NTNU, we are instead performing climate change into the climate chamber. So usually we are testing two types of wooden species, pine and oak, and in order to produce a strong moisture gradient inside the material, we seal the surface of the sample with several chemicals, several treatments. And so for this reason, we had this need to understand better in which way the treated pine and the untreated pine absorb moisture. And here, practically, this study. So we took a pine log that was naturally air-dry for 3 years, and then we prepared the sample. So we cut slices with dimension of 20 centimeter per 10 centimeter per 2 centimeter of thickness, and we treated 5 samples over 6. One sample remained untreated, so clear as standard, as reference, and then we treated 2 samples with paraloid, that is a sort of acrylic resin, a third sample with a preparatory layer of cellulose sand seal spray, the first sample with a microcrystalline wax, and then the last with an epoxy resin. We evaluate the thickness of the treatment with the optical microscope and the SEM, and then we evaluate the wettability of the surface measuring the contact angle. Practically, we obtained that the surface that was hydrorepellent was that one treated with a microcrystalline wax. Then we performed the real measurement. So we used the vacuum microbalance, and we put a small amount of each treated sample and the untreated sample on the balance. We outgas the sample before starting with the measurement, and then at constant temperature condition of 24 degrees, we modify the relative humidity and we measure the change in weight at every 10% of change in relative humidity. At the end, we obtain this water vapor sorption isotherm that is expressed as the volume of absorbed water over the change in relative humidity. And you see here every data set is practically the result for the treated sample, and in black instead you have the untreated, the standard sample of pine. Each data set can be fit with the gap equation, that is this one, that explains this relationship, and it has inside 3 different constant, gap constants. What is interesting in this model is that practically is able to explain the absorption isotherm over a larger range of relative humidity, so almost up to 90%, and also it has a quite strong, let's say, physical background that allows to understand in which stage you are of the absorption process. If we look at our result expressed in the table, so here you have the untreated sample and then the treated sample, you see that for each set we have different gap constants. So the first gap constant is VM, that is the monolayer capacity. So practically it explains the capacity to fill with a complete monolayer the surface of the material thanks to the filling of the hydrophilic binding site on the surface. But what we observe is that after the treatment, this value decreases. So practically we pass from this stage to this condition. It means that the treated surfaces have have lower presence of OH groups. And then, for the second constant, the gap constant, we observe also a decrease. In some such a case, the meaning of this constant is related with the wettability of the surface. So we observe that, for example, the microcrystalline walls, that was the surface that was hydrorepellent, is in a situation where the drop of water remains in a spherical shape. So it's difficult for a water drop practically to have a strength bound on the surface, and this means that the treatment practically decreases the strength of this bound with the first monolayer respect to the multilayer. In the third gap constant, that is K gap, this can be explained, so this decrease that we are observing except for the microcrystalline walls can be explained as a less favorable condition for saturation. So it means that it's more difficult to have liquid bulk above the multilayer. This is true for specifically the epoxy resin, but not for the microcrystalline walls that instead show more favorable condition to saturation. Then from the water vapor sorption isotherm is also possible to see this relation between the equilibrium moisture content and the relative humidity. This is an interesting relation for wood because it helps to explain which type of water you have inside the wood. So if you are at condition of relative humidity quite high, you are in this situation. So you have two types of water. You have free water, this one, into the lumen of the wood, and then you have bound water that instead is into the cell wall of the wood. What happens if you decrease in this direction the relative humidity? That you start losing the water in this direction, so you first lose the free water from the lumen, and then you arrive in a situation when you don't have free water but only bound water, and this situation occurs when you have the first derivative that is flat, let's say, at the minimum. And then if you decrease again the relative humidity, you start losing water from the cell structure of the wood. This is the condition of risk. So it means that in this condition here, you are losing water from the structure, so you are deforming your structure and you are creating plastic deformation. And this is the risk that we want to avoid, of course, in the stage of this kind of risk. So from the gap equation, it's also possible to estimate what is the water film thickness that you are absorbing at different level of relative humidity with this equation. So this is the thickness of the water. And you can put in relation this water film thickness with the third gap constant. And you see that this relation works quite well at the high value of relative humidity, so when you are almost approaching saturation, and this relation has the potentiality to discriminate between different types of chemicals that you use to seal the surface of the sample. And we observe, we made a similar analysis also with the data that we collected from the campaign in Trondheim. So in such a case, we collected a microsample from one microsample from each log of the decayed wall. This wall, as I told you before, was decayed because of the presence of the salt. So what happened? That practically you had salt inside the pore of the wood, and this created an oversaturation inside this pore. So you had the salt in the liquescence form and higher value of relative humidity. And this is evident because you have a higher value of the third gap constant. So thanks to this relation, you can also discriminate. You can also discriminate not only the treatment from something that is not treated, but also the level of the decay. So if you have more salts present, of course you have condition at saturation, and so you have higher value of the third gap constant. So in conclusion, we have found that this equation, it's important to study the water absorption up to relative humidity of 90%. You can have some insight about what is the effect, for example, of samples that are treated with different chemicals on the surface. You can understand when you have less available hydrophilic binding site, or you can have a surface that is more or less wettable. And also, from the first derivative of the equilibrium moisture content, you can understand if you have treatment that show a propension to gain more moisture or less. And from the relationship between the third gap constant and the water film thickness, you can have the potentiality to discriminate between the chemicals that you use to treat the sample and also between the status of the decay on real sample. Thank you.